Very good evening to you. Welcome to the People's Republic of Brighton and Hove. May I just say we're having a little celebration today.
Oh, we're showing them.
With cake.
With silver plates
with
as
cake,
well.
Because it is Andy's birthday.
I look quite good for 59, don't I?
You're not 59. On it. But anyway, very happy birthday.
I'm certainly old enough to listen to Southern Counties Radio's, ladies and gentlemen, and to watch the latest TV, which is what you're doing. And I'm so pleased you are.
Yes.
It's a delight. It's a sheer delight to see you. We've got a fantastic show for you this evening. We have Jacob from Brighton Migrant Solidarity, and we're going to follow that up with the guys from Neon Hair Boutique, who will be talking about male positivity workshops.
That's
You've got to stay tuned for that. Meanwhile, may we introduce to you the wonderful Jacob.
The wonderful Jacob, hello.
Jacob,
thank
welcome.
You so much for joining us today. And you're from Brighton Migrant Solidarity.
That's right, hello, yes.
So
happy birthday.
Yeah.
Oh, cheers, man. Thank you. And to you, whenever it is.
Thank you, March.
March.
So, March.
Okay, make a note in your diary, okay, in March.
We'll definitely send you a card. So
would you like to tell us about, please tell us about Brighton Migrant Solidarity. I understand it's an organisation.
That's right. So Brighton Migrant Solidarity, we set up in 2013, 14, something like that. It's the sort of latest iteration of... it's not even the latest anymore, actually. Iteration of kind of Brighton migrant solidarity groups working against the border and for a more open and inclusive society. But the thing I think really that distinguishes Brighton Migrant Solidarity is that we set up a housing charity in Brighton called Thousand for 1,000 to try and mobilise the community to house house people without regular immigration status. And so if you don't have leave to remain in this country, so for example you're an asylum seeker, or perhaps you have a child here but you for whatever reason haven't sorted out your papers, you're not allowed to work and you have very, very limited access to any state money, and so you just can't get a house in Brighton. And we wanted to do something about that. Back in 2014, 2015, when fortunately there was this kind of outpouring of support and solidarity for refugees and other migrants, I think basically because it became really visible on our screens, when the kind of European border was threatened, or fell temporarily, really, and then people sort of mobilised because, you know, we've got this problem, we can do something about it. It was a very wonderful moment. We said we're going to set up this housing charity, we're going to try and find houses for people, and we're going to try and create a politics of welcome and a community of welcome.
Now, that's the uniqueness of it, isn't it? So you're talking about those people who have arrived on our shores, who've actually moved into Brighton and Hove, sanctuary by sea, as occasionally termed, who are not legally able to work yet.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
So that
those people.
And you're working alongside some other rather brilliant organisations like...
Refugee Radio, Voices in Exile.
Refugee Radio, Voices in Exile.
The Hummingbird.
Yes, indeed.
It's a really, we've got a really lovely ecology
of
support groups.
And I'm really pleased and it's really useful that you singled out the uniqueness there. It's the housing.
Yeah.
And you've also attached the other stuff around it. What numbers of people have needed homes then?
Probably more than we see. We've supported around 30 people. A few more. Haven't been able to house all of them, unfortunately. So there are, it's really heartbreaking, there are some people that are still homeless. We need more money.
Do they end up on the streets?
Some of the time, yes. I mean, in fact, there's one guy, hopefully we've got him somewhere to stay from the end of this month, and we're looking to do something now. But for example, he's sleeping rough at the moment. And there was another guy earlier this year who we couldn't house. I think he didn't have papers, but somehow got himself to Germany, apparently, anyway, where he thought he had a better chance of claiming asylum from So, yeah, it does happen, unfortunately.
I have a couple of questions around that. One is wondering about the response in the city. Now, we live in Brighton and Hove. It's a beautiful city. The people in our city, bunch of citizens of the Republic. Yeah. Do you get any pockets of pushback? Because there is a right-wing uprising in the country.
Not really. I mean, every now and then I get, nervous speaking and, I'm going to say these kind of radical things that we're against the border or and that we should make space for all and these kind of things. And I always expect I'm going to get some pushback. And, it has happened, but, the most criticism I got was I complained that the... I said, we have a really racist border system and that it, and although there's a kind of xeno-racism, it's against foreigners that really... It's still around colour to some extent, I think, and that, I think Africans, particularly black Africans, have a worse time of it in the asylum system than others, I think. And the pushback I got was someone saying, that's not right. I mean, it's, it's the same whether you're from Albania or from Zimbabwe. I mean, I think he's wrong, but, but he thought the racism was kind of deeper than I did. So actually, no, we haven't. I mean, sometimes on the streets, when we've done kind of sort of protests, I mean, we didn't organise it, but the Stands to 15 stuff, I don't know if you saw these, with the people who stopped. So one of them's from Brighton, there were 15 of them, and they got themselves onto the runway at the back of Gatwick. Well, they weren't on the runway, actually, they were around the back of the airport.
Oh, yeah, Gatwick, I remember being blocked, spells, yes.
Blocked a charter flight, a charter deportation flight going to Ghana and Nigeria, I think. And, in fact, have saved the lives of several people who were on that flight. And, of course, they were... prosecuted under some terrorism-related laws and convicted, although they ended up they didn't get prison time in the end, which was really good. And I think partly because of the kind of outpouring of support for them after the awful conviction. And one of them, Lindsay, is from Brighton, and so we had a solidarity demo here. And I remember then she was speaking. I mean, this amazing woman put her her liberty on the line.
Yes.
And he was saying, you should let people into your house. What are you talking about? You want refugees here? Then let's... Any idea what this woman has done? Right. And of course, she just stood up and said, and we can support 1,000 for 1,000, and we can make homes for people. So, we get a bit, but basically, no. I found not. But I think it's very easy as well to have the kind of those kind of difficult conversations with people, because people are human. And,
you'd like to think so.
I think when you're open and you're honest with people and you're kind of able to take the conversation beyond kind of slogans and...
Yes, misconceptions.
And misconceptions.
And you're able to show the whole picture and not just their narrow view of what's going on. And to be able to sort of put out there, the reality of the situation. One thing that I'm really interested to know, Jacob, and one thing that I would like the Republic to... think about is, how do people get involved? How do people in the Republic who are watching this thinking, gosh, that's a really great cause, they're doing some really amazing things, which you are.
Thank you.
What can they do? How can our Republic, who's got a bit of time on their hands or might have a particular skill or a particular area of expertise, be able to step
in? I also invite you to answer the question how and also why.
Yeah. Why?
And why?
Okay.
Yeah,
how am I? Well, the why I think is easier in some sense. Written on the you might not know this, but we written on the gates of Brighton. There's two big pylons to come into Brighton. It says, "Hail guest, we ask not what thou art. If friend, we greet thee, hand and heart. If stranger such no longer be, if foe our love shall conquer thee." So that's what we write on the gates of Brighton. And I know that because one of our members, Danny, she made this beautiful blanket quilt, really. With that message on it, and that's kind of our slogan.
That's a good slogan.
It's a good slogan, and I think basically my world is richer than Donald Trump's world, right? My world is richer than anyone who is afraid of strangers and thinks that they're dangerous.
Yeah.
And so is your world. And diversity is the basic fundamental human good.
Absolutely.
And so making a diverse town where there is space for everybody makes everybody's lives richer and better. So that's why we should get involved.
That's a good answer, by the way.
I mean, we need money. In a lot of it, in the end, making people welcome requires cash. And small amounts every month make a massive difference to people. You can sign up at our website, which is 1000for1000.org.uk.
1000for1000.org.uk.
Which would be great. We need help with, particularly with publicity and putting on events, getting regular donations. But if you've got event skills, we'd really like that. There's the Migrant English Project in Brighton. They need support teaching people. I think Voices in Exile need more volunteers to sort of support people going up to sign when you have to go to the Home Office to sign every month.
Yes.
And just generally give people support. I imagine the Hummingbirds still need volunteers because they do cross his classroom, probably. So there's lots of little organisations in Brighton doing lots of little things. But for me, it's about supporting these projects. Some of that's with time, some of that's with money. And generally sort of spreading love, really.
Spreading love. And what we're going to do is we're going to share all of those details on our Facebook page so people can get in touch, they can support you in everything that you're doing. It's been great talking to you, Jacob.
And
what you're doing is absolutely amazing. And thank you very much for watching, and we'll join you after the break.
Hello and welcome to another mind-blowing edition of the People's Republic of Brighton and Hove radio show on the television. Hello, Madeline, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I think I'm all right, yeah.
Do you think? It's Monday.
Yeah, well, it's Monday when we're... It's not Monday, it's Thursday.
It's always Monday.
That's why... Oh, it's always Monday. God, mind blown already. It's always Monday in Tory Britain.
Yeah, anyway.
Anyway.
That part is a bit negative, but we need to get going
smooth.
With the positive talk.
Let's get positive.
We need to look at the good things that are happening.
Yes.
So today we have got Alex and Ben here. Hello.
Hiya.
Would you like to just take a moment to tell us about what you're doing and the impact that you're having in our wonderful republic?
Sure.
No pressure.
We don't know. Why not?
Cheer
we don't
us
know
up
what impact we're going to have yet because it's our first meeting. But I noticed there was a real lack of anything out there for men that was positive. My partner was able to go to these fantastic meetup groups, business-wise. There wasn't anything out there for men to meet up that was positive. I went to a few things that were a bit more in line with Fathers for Justice and things like that.
Okay.
And whilst the message that they were sending was really good, it wasn't a positive build-up for men. It was just very sort of negative and very... Some of it was actually a bit misogynistic, and I just thought that in Brighton, we're very metrosexual kind of people. We're not all connected by sport. We're not all alpha males. And there wasn't anything out there. And as time goes on, you have friends that you lose from university, meeting people. You don't always connect with the people that you meet at the school gates. And I just thought there might be a way of connecting guys together and doing it in a positive way. So running a meeting where we could learn something, we could all discuss things openly. There's a big problem out there, as we know, with depression. And it was so sick of hearing about that, and that I thought, why can't we do something that was positive? So hopefully we're going to get a group of guys together that will all get on, that have all got stuff in common, that can all learn something from the lovely Ben here as well. And then go about and spread the message and connect with other guys. And one of the most important things that we want to just say is how important it is for guys to talk and to open up a narrative with each other, because everyone's got stuff in common. You know, it's not just what hangs between your legs. It's also the stuff that you do on a general day-to-day basis. You know, I work as a hairdresser and I meet so many guys and I'm able to have an open conversation with them. And I just thought, you know, if I'm able to have an open conversation with someone that's sitting in a chair and having their hair cut with a set of scissors to them, then why can't exactly? It's not what it is.
That's part of your job, right? Not
I'm forcing them to speak. But why can't we get guys to just talk about regular things like that we talk to our pubs about, talk to people in the pubs
before we
about.
We didn't slip there.
We mainly talk about pubs during the meeting.
Yeah, fair enough. Where do you hold this in pubs?
So, we're going to do it. The first one we're holding in my hairdressing salon.
The Neon Hair Boutique.
Neon Hair Boutique in Powis Road in Brighton.
Excellent. And are you going to be cutting hair while you're doing
it? We can do. Yeah. If you want to come in for a haircut, rather than doing hair. We're getting Ben cutting hair, and I'm actually going to do the personal training. Ben's we're going to do a whole job swap and see how that goes.
So Ben's personal training. How's that?
So, yeah, right. We were looking for speakers for our first event.
Right.
And actually, one of the things that I noticed for myself, I had struggles with substance abuse, and one of the ways that I beat it was obviously giving up substances and alcohol, but was to start exercising. And I just found that the positivity that I got through exercising, through endorphins, was great. And it has such a way of building people together. A lot of men are brought together by, like I said, football teams and things like that. But actually, just doing a bit of exercise, not only does it keep you alive longer, unless you go out running and get hit by a bus, that will shorten your life significantly. But if you're going out and you're doing exercise, it has such a way of getting endorphins into you. And actually, I think all men can connect by doing some sort of sport. You know, we're bringing Ben in to sort of say, look, you don't have to go to the gym every single day. You can do a little bit of exercise, change your diet a little bit, and it will have such a positive impact on your mental mindset for doing during the day.
I think that dual benefit of the physical and the mental.
Yeah.
I was doing a lot of exercise, then I had to have surgery, and then I stopped, and I am bummed out.
Yeah.
I just want to get back to doing what I'm doing.
Yeah.
But mostly because there's a community there. You know, we're kind of like a family in our gym. I get people messaging me, sort of saying, where are we going? Yeah. You know, so having those things. And I think, you know, if I go to a shop and I see Men's Health magazine, you know, it's like ripped guy. Mm.
Yeah.
It's like always there's such a focus from my perception of men having to be the best version.
Yeah.
That's it. And we're inundated with these images, and a lot of them are setting these unrealistic standards. Mm. And this is the elite level, when really, you know, us everyday people, we only need to do little bits here and there to help improve our physicality and our mentality as well. And this is what I'll be... thank you.
I like this one.
Quick, write it down.
and this is what, you know, a lot of my chat is going to be focused on in terms of the realistic takeaways, the little things. They add up. It's the consistencies over a long period of time, not that one super mega workout that you did. Yeah. That's not going to count for the rest of the year. So is trying to get those kind of more realistic things in on a daily basis, eating just that little bit better and exercising that little bit more.
Yeah.
And the little things that get forgotten about, sleeping, that sort of thing, people kind of really let that go to the side. And it is difficult in modern day lives, of course.
Yeah. Well, that's like you say, it's the little bits. You don't have to have a massive leap.
Yeah.
No.
Do a marathon or something.
Exactly.
You can just do a couple of kilometres or whatever.
Yeah.
Exactly, add it up, you know. Yeah. All smartphones will have step counters, and you know they're not accurate by any standard, but they still give you a ballpark figure, and off of that ballpark figure, add 1,000 steps every week. And by the time you get to that 10,000 steps, you're going to be feeling better for simply being outdoors and for simply moving.
Yeah.
You know, and that's something that people can do instead of sitting in front of the TV. Half-hour program. Well, you could have had a half-hour walk and a chat with your partner. You could have walked with your children. You know. There's little excuse you can have for
and
it.
And it's definitely, even like you said, walking with your children or going out with your partner, it does connect you. It does connect you to the people around you. And, you know, we're not sort of saying, like, we're super mega ripped people and you should be like the people that you see on Love Island or anything like that.
Definitely not.
We're just... I'm not. I can't even swim. But we're just sort of saying, look, you know, this is a starting point of a narrative of getting guys to talk. Mm. And actually, you know, I think most people can talk about exercise, and what Ben's really good about is helping people to identify what their body types are. And you know, I think that most people will identify when you look in the mirror, there's always little bits and pieces, you know, that you struggle with, whether you've got love handles or you've got, you know, I think I shave my beard off once a year and then I always go, oh shit, I've still got a double
back.
chin, but you know, it's one of those things that we are so inundated with negativity from, you know, supposedly positive things of putting people up on pedestals that are Adonis-like, and it has a chip away impact on your psyche that you're not good enough. And this group is telling people that you are good enough, and there are also other guys around you that will support you. You know, we don't support each other enough.
Yeah.
It's all about being better than the next person, more competitive. And actually, this is not about that as a group. It's about coming together as a group of guys and sort of saying, look, I'm here for you if you need me. Mm. I'm on the other end of the phone. I haven't met you before, but actually I don't have enough friends and I could always do with more people. Yeah. And it's connecting people, and getting a speaker like Ben in first is just really being able to find a common ground. There's always common ground between everyone. Mm. And that's what it is. You know,
self-confidence as well. It's like self-confidence.
Yeah, exactly. And it's giving people a bit of self-confidence.
And instead of that kind of, sorry, to cut you off.
No.
Instead of having like such a, you know, don't get me wrong, people are in the gym or doing their exercise to look and feel a bit better, but also having a focus on functionality. And it's not sexy to be sold, but what about later in life when you want to be able to get up the stairs, get yourself in and out of a bar? Like, that's the goal of everyone, in my opinion, is to be healthy when you get older and to be independent when you're older. So this isn't sold on men's health on the cover when you've got this ripped individual.
Yes. Yeah.
And so it's talking from that perspective as well, and that you should be focusing more so on health and have a bit of that aesthetic behind you.
Makes loads of sense, when you're old like me, you know, I can still get out of the bath.
Well, there you go.
That's a good thing.
That's
good
you're on the right path.
Yeah, that's a good thing. And I mean, hopefully with these events, if they do take hold, we want to do a series of four on different things that I think all men will connect with. So the first one is about body image and health. And then I want to do one on finance. We're going to do one on family life, work balance, and also finally one on depression and happiness.
Okay.
And how those two connect and how we're so desperate to be happy and how you can find happiness. And it's not just a way of, you know, there are so many people that earn millions of pounds that still aren't happy. And there are so many people that just find happiness or find ways to find happiness. And it's all about shifting your perception of what you find to make you happy.
It's like we're in this environment that is there to make you negative and unhappy.
Yeah, and exactly.
Lifting yourself out of that environment to
there
actually
is.
Be a human.
There's so much stuff in the media as well at the moment that does bring you down. And you know, and I'm so tired of, you know, focusing. And there are phrases that get thrown around that it's okay not to be okay. That is okay. Mm. But it's also okay to talk to people and it's okay to put a front on things. Mm. And it's okay to, you know, I applaud people for powering through. It is so difficult if you're not feeling okay within yourself to get up and go to work and just act normally.
But we're in our final few minutes, few seconds, minutes.
Yeah.
How do people get in contact with you?
Okay,
and when's it happening?
They can come to the event, obviously, on the 19th at Neon Hair Boutique.
Yeah.
There's a Facebook page that'll be going up, so you can connect to us on Facebook.
Right.
And there'll be some stuff that's going up online as well. So if they want to look, they can follow our Neon Hair Boutique Facebook page. And obviously, Ben's got some information. Benny
Great.
Fit.
Brilliant.
Thank
that's
you
excellent.
So much.
Okay.
And we are going to see you next time.